Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick with my third video. You know, if I would be diligent and more organized to put out my videos in short bursts of facts, I could have had probably a whole lot more people seeing the videos. And that's why I'm going to do it, because the information needs to get out, brothers and sisters. And it's just got to be in a format, unfortunately, where it can be spoon-fed to people who cannot focus on a longer video. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you guys. Think about this. Straight out of Masonry. You know, I used to be into Masons before. I joined the Masons because my dad was a Mason. I went through all that. And then I wasn't active because it's usually old people. But after I became a pastor, became a Christian, and became a pastor, the Lord told me to throw away my stuff, destroy it. And I even took my Masonic ring and put it in a collection plate with a note at the church I went to, First Assemblies of God, and told, you know, I made an anonymous note. Even though my name was engraved in the ring, but I made an anonymous note that I want to give a testimony. Thank the Lord for delivering me from the lies of Masonry. I didn't go into it, but I went to go see the assistant pastor, and I was telling him that the Lord told me that He would use me to deal with Masonry. That there's something bad about Masonry, but I didn't know what it was because I was new then, new in the ministry. I didn't know anything. I just knew that the Lord told me it was evil. That He wanted to use me to expose it one day. And when I told that guy this, he said, what's a classic comment that people say? Well, you know, my uncle was in the Masons, and he was a great guy. He was a Christian. There's nothing wrong with Masonry. You know, and that is the reason why Masonry exists. The low-level Masonry, like I was, a third degree, a Master Mason. It's not until you get way up high to the higher levels, like up to the 33rd degree, and then they have even supposedly this stuff higher than that that you have to invite you to join, that's, you know, up to the 99th degree and all this other stuff, where it gets into Satanism. But the lower levels are giving you the information, but you don't know that it's Satanism. Just as Albert Pike said, you know, in his writings, he said that, there's the initiates, the cannon fodder out there, and then they see a symbol and you tell them that it means, like the G in the square and compass with the G, they'll tell him it means God or it means geometry. Hey, you know, that's cool. That's cool. You know, and then they don't explain anymore. We're not sure what it means, but they know what it means. It means lots of things. It means like gold. It means that you are a god. It means gold. But gold, when it's taken from the initiate level to the highest level, like alchemy, which is what people think is turned lead into gold. I made videos about this a long time ago, a couple years ago. As the Lord had showed me, there's different levels in all this. There's the initiate level, then the mid-level, whatever, all the way to the top, and levels that I don't even know unless the Lord showed me. But a deeper meaning of lead to gold is you becoming God. You know that God, gold is associated with something that doesn't corrupt. It's associated with God. Just like in that movie they just had, was it Clash of the Titans? I can't remember. I think it was Clash of the Titans. And then the gods came down and fought, and they were all gold. You know, they were in this gold paint and gold clothes. Now that's how they associate gold. So turning lead to gold is turning from flesh human into a god. So that's a deeper meaning and the ultimate meaning of what alchemy is. You become a god. Man becomes a god. The theme of the Antichrist will be you can be a god. We don't need some god pie in the sky way off in heaven. We can have paradise right here on earth. We can make our own paradise. God has abandoned us. God doesn't care about us. We need to have our own heaven right here, right now on earth. Something like that is the message of the Antichrist. As it says, he will speak boastfully and great blasphemies against the Most High God. He will speak openly and blasphemy against God. He will declare himself that he is God. Anyway, brothers and sisters, let me throw this nugget out that I started to make the video about to connect to this. I'm talking about Masonry, and I'm talking about the lies of the devil, from the lowest simpleton lie to the greatest, deepest, darkest lie. Okay? Just like that blazing star that's in the middle of the Masonic floor, and everybody talks about all this other stuff. And about the, you know, in the Egyptians that they worship the sun. In actuality, the sun is what they told the laborers at the temple, the pyramids. Oh, we're worshiping the sun. In reality, they're worshiping Sirius, the dog star. That's what that blazing star is. It's the dog star Sirius. Canaan, the land of Canaan, is from the same root word where we say canine for a dog. The dog star, you've heard, if you have any old people in your family that's ever been farmers like that, and they talk about the dog days of summer, like the movie Dog Day Afternoon about some perverted transsexual people. That movie, Dog Day Afternoon, Dog Days, that expression, the dog days, is referring all the way back to the worship of the dog star Sirius. celebrated, recorded, the celebrations were recorded at that time of year when we call the dog days. That was celebrated in Rome, but it goes all the way back to the Tower of Babel, the worship of Mars and the dog star Sirius, brothers and sisters. Anyway, this stuff goes all the way back to Nimrod, all the way back to the very beginning. So what the Masonry say, right out of their, because I wasn't a Mason, right out of their catechism, they have a catechism. Every level you have to memorize the catechism, and you have to say it in front of the whole lodge, or, you know, and then you have someone asking you questions and you answer back. It's a lot of memorization. You're speaking like 15 minutes from memory. And every level you have this catechism you have to memorize. So in one of the catechisms, it says something like this. It says, from the high and lofty Tower of Babel, where Masonry was confounded and language was lost, to the three-tiered threshing floor of Ordinan the Jebusite, where Masonry was found and language restored. Now, Ordinan the Jebusite is the one who King David bought the threshing floor from, where King Solomon's temple was built. Now, Masons claim, you know, from there, you know, they came from Lebanon under this Hiram of Tyre, you know, who donated the cedars and all that to build. There's another fraternity that used to be called the Tall Cedars of Lebanon, but you know, it was not really big and like the Masons. Masons have been around for hundreds of years. Goes back to the Rosicrucians, back to the Knights Templar, at least, and all the way back to ancient Egypt, Babylon, and all that. Of course, the Knights Templar got their wisdom from the Muslims, from the, you know, the ancient Egyptian mystery religions, all the way back to Babylon. That's the bridge to the Europeans, really, is through the Knights Templar to the Rosicrucians to the Masons. Anyway, the keepers of this esoteric wisdom that came from Satan in the garden through the fallen angels and their offspring, the Nephilim, and all that, what they call sacred wisdom, sacred geometry, all that stuff, has just been passed down all the way from the beginning of time. And it's your mystery religions. It's your Gnosticism. Salvation through wisdom. This is Albert Pike said, you know, to reveal the kingdom of Lucifer. Go look up Albert Pike. He was into bestiality and all kinds of stuff. What a freak. Co-founder of the Ku Klux Klan. And his body, his ashes are there in Washington, D.C. at I think it's the 33rd Street or whatever it is, or the 33rd Street above the Washington Monument or whatever it is there in Washington, D.C., whatever. It means something to these devil's people, but in reality, it doesn't mean anything. But they believe it. Okay. So anyway, brothers and sisters, the thing that the Lord quickened in my spirit about that today, okay, is that the devil's people, what they're saying is, what is the thing about Masonry? All the way back to King Solomon's temple. Masonry goes back there. Now they're speculative Masons. They were practicing Masons through the Middle Ages. They built all the cathedrals of Europe and all that. That's the same Masons. They had secret signs and handshake because no one could travel freely in those days without their papers. You know, a peasant couldn't travel or carry arms. You know, that's really why the United States was established in all those hundreds of years. And so, but Masons belonged to a guild, and they started the guild like a union. And they had these handshakes and passwords and all that. Part of the reason why they had those things is so they could pass this secret knowledge of literally building buildings. Now, those people who are literally building a building, that is the laborers, like the laborers who built the pyramids. They're the workers. You tell them, oh, this means this and this means that. And when you make an arch and you do this, you put a keystone in there and blah, blah, blah. That's true. That's literal information, the practical application of this information. But at a higher level, it means this, and in the next level it means this, and the next level it means this, and then later on you can become a god. That's what it gets to the top. Lucifer is God. I mean, that's where it all goes to. That's where all of this wisdom goes to, but the lower level. So you talk to a guy that's a regular Mason, he's like, well, you know, it's only this, it's only that. Yeah, that's all he's been told. He hasn't sought more light. When you join the Masons, you're blindfolded, and they take you in there and say, what do you desire? And then you're supposed to say, more light. And then they give you more light. But it's not the light of God. It's the light of Lucifer. It's illumination. Like illuminate, same word. Illumined one. Lucifer means the enlightened one, the illuminated one. Anyway, brothers and sisters. So how do they communicate? You're talking about people from different countries. See, they lost language at the Tower of Babel. And then I've said this before. The church regained language. One thing about Pentecost. The reason why God gave us tongues with interpretation, it says that in Christ, That's why everyone should speak in tongues. In one angle of saying this, everyone should speak in tongues because it's overcoming what happened at the Tower of Babel. When you speak in tongues, you have overcome what happened at the Tower of Babel. You're speaking a language that can be understood by any Christian as the Lord wills. That we as Christians have overcome our earthly limitation of our own known language, our known languages. And then by the power of God, we can overcome that. Besides the fact that the Bible says, build up your most holy faith, praying in the Spirit. And you can have major breakthrough by praying in the Spirit because you know not what to pray, but the Holy Spirit gives you, you know, this groanings that cannot be uttered, you know, in our own understanding, but by the groanings of the Holy Spirit, in our spirit. Anyway, what they've done, brothers and sisters, the way the devil overcomes. Now, I know that Brother Andrew Cassell, you got to watch that. I hope you're watching this because this is right up your alley. The way the devil overcomes the language thing that God stole from the devil's people at the Tower of Babel by confounding the languages and dispersing the people is symbolism. It's symbolism, brothers and sisters. That's what the Lord told me today. I never thought about it before. All this stuff about the Triton and the Fleur-de-Lis and all those other symbolisms that, you know, that the Lord has showed me and other people made videos about for years, and people have been talking about it for years and years and years. All these symbols that's evil and all that stuff. That is the international way that the devil tries to overcome what God cursed and confounded the people's languages at the Tower of the Babel with symbolism. And that's why Masonry is all that is full of allegory, symbolism, and all these kind of things. That way that it's a universal language, brothers and sisters. So when you see these people, you know, I used to think when I first heard people saying this stuff, they were nuts. You know, people making signs and, you know, George Bush doing all this. And they said that he was doing the Texas Longhorns. Maybe he was. I don't know. But it also means like the devil's horns and all that. This is, you know, when they made like the Olympic thing. You know, people, some moron, some people, overzealous, immature people. See, I'm learning to be a little bit politically correct when needed. Some people made videos saying that it was going to be the beginning of World War III and blah, 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 tribulation, all this tied to the Olympics. But when they did, but see, that's what makes you dismiss the whole thing. When you hear all that wacky stuff and then nothing happens, which I knew it wasn't going to happen, then you dismiss what people say. That's the problem. But the reality is, if you go watch the open ceremonies in London, in England, that was the most wacky, crazy, demonic, witchcraft crap you've ever seen. Okay, if you go watch that. And it's all symbolic. They are sending a message to those who have an evil eye to see and an evil ear to hear. He who has a demonic mind to understand, let him understand what the devil is saying to his people. I mean, that's what's going on with all the symbolism, brothers and sisters. There's really something to it. The Lord quickened my spirit about it today, and I want to put this out. God bless you guys. Love you guys. And I just want to add a caveat on here. You know, we have all power over the enemy, and I'm going to be talking about this stuff. I guess I need to say it in every video because different people see it that didn't see it before. You know, the devil, no weapon formed against us shall prosper, the Bible says. We have authority over all the power of the enemy. But we need to be aware, brothers and sisters. As Paul said, you know, we are not ignorant of the devil's devices. The devil wants to snare us, to hinder us, to kill, steal, and destroy us. And we need to be aware. We need to be alert. The Bible says to be, you know, to be vigilant, to be sober, Peter said. To be sober. That means don't be getting drunk. Be vigilant. Because the devil is like a roaring lion walking about seeking whom he may devour. And I will say to you that, and that's King James. These other translations say seeking someone to devour. It says seeking who he can devour. He cannot devour me because I'm trying, because by the grace of God, I'm abiding in Christ. Let me add that. Not because of me, but by the grace of God, may I abide in Christ. And that's something else the Lord spoke to me again today. The Lord's been speaking to me today more than maybe he ever has. I could probably make 1,000 videos today. You know, the Bible says, you know, take heed when you stand, at least you fall. Because just when you think you stand, you can fall. So just when you think you got it licked, you got it going on, you're the man or the woman, you think you're some hot stuff, that's when you can fall. Pride goes before a fall, a hearty spirit before destruction. So I will say that, and I'm adding that, and I know that. I want to put this out there for you as an example. Anybody can fall. I can fall, but by the grace of God. But by the grace of God. God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. That's the biggest problem I deal with on YouTube. Talking to people about doctrines and all this. And 90% of the time they're wrong. But there are times when I can be wrong or misinterpreted, or their idea could be just as right as mine. Or both could be wrong, or both could be, you know, or you know, they both could possibly be right. Don't know. And 90% of the people that I talk to, they think that everybody that their little doctrine, which is not essential to salvation, their little doctrine, if anybody disagrees with them, they're a false prophet, they're evil, there's, you know, it doesn't even fathom their mind that they might be wrong. And that is the very, what worries me as a pastor is the fact that if they're so arrogant and so unmovable about a small issue, which is really not the end of the world, which is, you know, there's variances we can allow here and you're still a Christian. You know, you don't have to believe in the rapture to go to heaven. You don't have to believe that you got to read a King James Bible to go to heaven. There are people, brothers and sisters, say you go to hell if you don't say the name, you know, the sacred namers. All these different doctrines that people have. And the thing, not even the doctrines, brothers, that's where they can't even get it. They're so blinded and they're so simple-minded. What worries me is their arrogance and pride. If they have pride in this, maybe they have pride in everything else. Maybe they have self-righteous pride in everything. They're not, you know, God gives grace to the humble. By grace are you saved through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God. Not by works, lest any man should boast. I'm worried, and I believe that lots of these people that I've chat with that want to debate, I believe and I hope and pray for them in their heart. They have a haughty spirit, not just about one topic, but about everything. They're self-righteous. These are the very people, brothers and sisters, that's going to be left behind. The very people that won't go up higher. They're the very people that's going to be taken in that turbulent, muddy floodwaters, that sudden destruction that's coming upon this earth, upon all of mankind, as Jesus said, to try all the people on earth, to try all of mankind. That tribulation is coming. Sudden destruction. And they shall not escape. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, and he will give you strength. Humble yourself right now. I beseech thee. That means I petition you. I ask you. I beg you in the name of Jesus Christ. Humble yourself. Humble yourself and stop majoring in the minors. Stop choking on a gnat and swallowing a camel, as the Lord Jesus Christ said. You don't know how many people I've got, you know, who are nitpicky about the pronunciation of the name Yeshua and instead of Jesus and all this other nitpicky stuff. But in the meantime, they're going to hell in a handbasket. Their whole world is all upside down in a whole mess, and they're worried, straining on a gnat and swallowing a camel. They're majoring in the minors. Wake up. Wake up. It's just so easy. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, and Jesus will help you prioritize your mind, your spirit, and your life. That you can get those things done that the Lord wants you to do and let the rest go. Because brothers and sisters, as they say, you know, Lord, give me the wisdom to know the things I can change, and you know, and the things I cannot change, and I'm sure somebody who has a hobby, I'm thinking of one person right now who will probably put the right quote on here, but it says, you know, how to know the difference between things you can change and things you cannot change, that you may have the wisdom to know the difference between what you can affect and what you cannot affect. Brothers and sisters, narrow is the way. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. The only way that you're going to go to heaven, the only way you're going to get out of this world and go to heaven is through the blood of Jesus, through the grace of the living God, by his grace and mercy, through the blood of Jesus, through the sacrifice, the crucified, resurrected Lord Jesus Christ is the only way to enter the kingdom of heaven. Not by having the right doctrine, not by pronouncing Hebrew names right, not by debating and arguing every little issue with people on YouTube. Brothers and sisters, humble yourself. God gives grace to the humble. Humble yourself and turn your heart to Jesus. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Turn your eyes off the world. Turn your eyes off everything, but turn your eyes upon the Lord Jesus Christ. Call upon his name right now. Say, Lord Jesus, forgive me my sins. Lord Jesus, I know you died on the cross in my place. I deserve death. Your word, Lord Jesus, says that the wages of sin is death. Like you told Adam and Eve, if they ate the fruit, they would surely die. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. Lord, I know that you took my place. I deserve to be on that cross, but you got on the cross for me. When you were on the cross, I was on your mind. You loved the world so much that you gave your only son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and that I believe in him, and that I will not perish but have everlasting life, because I put all my faith, all my trust, all my hope in going to heaven, not in pronouncing the name right, not in water baptism, not in speaking in tongues, but in the finished work of Christ, that he took my sin and gave me his righteousness. He took my filthy deeds and gave me, and my filthy rags of my deeds, and gave me a white robe of his righteousness. I am the righteousness of Christ by faith, through the blood of Jesus, by grace, through faith. I've been saved, not of anything that I can do or be, but by his work alone, the work of the Lord, by the mystery of his Holy Spirit working in my heart. The Lord has set me free. Those whom the Son has set free are free indeed. I'm free in Christ. All things are expedient. All things are to me, but they're not always expedient, as the Apostle Paul said. I'm free in Christ. I can eat pork or not eat pork. I can go to church every day or not go to church for a month. I can stand on my head or not stand on my head. I can run. I can walk. I can sing. I can wear shorts. You can wear makeup or not wear makeup. You can wear whatever you want. Be all things in Christ. Hallelujah. Do all things to the glory of God. God bless you guys. By the grace of God, I'll see you on the other side, up there with the Lord. If not, contact me. I'm going to be, the Lord has commanded me and spoke to me today to go to Seattle, Vancouver, and Portland area. I'll be flying into Seattle by the grace of God, I think about the 7th of August. I'll be there for 2 weeks by the grace of God. Contact me if you are in the Northwest. Let's make the schedule. This is the Lord's will. The Lord has things he wants to get done before his return for his church in that area. The Lord has a mighty work to do in that area through me, through you guys, working together in the kingdom of God. Let's do it.